Sorry.
I'm in a bathrobe, so I'm not as, you know, I don't, I want to be presentable for you. You know, it's embarrassing. But yeah, I
actually usually imagine you in a bathrobe or in a trench coat, and it's kind of similar. It's like a fuzzy trench coat, really. And, you know, kind of sometimes with a patch from Pink Floyd's The Wall. I don't know why, but I just feel like that.
I don't actually have a patch from Pink Floyd's The Wall, but I'm a huge fan of Pink Floyd's The Wall.
I can see you not needing the patch because you actually are a brick in the wall. So it's okay.
I'm a brick in the wall, all in all. Yeah.
Yeah,
for this conversation with you in particular, what I'm excited to work with you about is ABBA. I know that you have an appreciation there, and I feel like there's not that many people that I could talk to that might be able to give the same type of feedback as you. And so my hope here is to just kind of do a walkthrough of kind of the discography and the correspondent syncs that have taken years to compile. And discuss some of the bleed over into events that, you know, I don't know if you've seen Sorry Cassandra all the way through.
Yeah, totally. But I've got people that were in my Discord that were like, hey, where did it go? It was like a big issue. Like a few days ago, everyone was freaking out. And I was like, well, he did just post this, by the way, everyone, ladies and gentlemen, and those in between is David Plate. He's got a crazy deep mind and huge understanding of everything from, I think the first thing that really blew my mind was when you talked about NY and OZ with New York and the Land of Oz and getting into kind of the Blavatsky look at Baum's Wizard of Oz. And you synchronize movies to music. Like a lot of people are familiar, I think, with The Wizard of Oz and The Dark Side of the Moon. Well, I don't think everyone realizes just how deep that is and how many people are actually synchronizing soundtracks when they make them in movies, thinking about, like, the band is thinking about it, the movie producer, the sound producer in films are now thinking about it. And in a lot of ways, it might be, for some people, surely is, that they're doing, and I know it, I'm one of them, like that they're doing their art thinking about it because David Plate had made a synchronization that they saw. Because you've made, 1,000, you know, different synchronizations and explain why they make sense and the interesting little correlations that are found in between them. I don't know, maybe you want to go into like your interest in that.
Well, there is actually an interview with Reality Sandwich that's a written interview that is on the on my page with all my videos. And that, and you know, if I was to do like the classic walkthrough of my history there, it's pretty complex. So I like that that exists as like a resource for people if they're interested, that they want to know, because it's so funny. I would get this one complaint about, you know, my video page where it's like, it's too much information at the header. And then I changed it and I got, there's not enough information in the header. And so I'm like, okay, well, I'm getting complaints if there's too much and I'm getting complaints if there's not enough. And so I felt like a good compromise was just to have that link to the Reality Sandwich interview with Tamara Lucid.
That's a good point. I'm going to put that link here too, actually. That's a really good interview just in general. I like to look at it sometimes in how I'm thinking about interviewing people. But I know that it's also an older part of your existence, and there's a lot more that you're interested in that you've spent a lot of time studying, like the deep parts of philosophy, metaphysics, metacognition, the Kabbalah, the Zohar, abracadabra, like Thelema, like you've looked at books, you know, you understand a lot of things. So your synchronizations have more to do with a deep, mystical, meaningful connection and trying to find what's meaningful to these different things. I think that's one of the things that I love about your interest in things is that it's a deep and caring interest. So your interest in ABBA, do you want to go into like why, how did we first, like, I guess we were at a concert or something, or we were at a festival and then we were talking about ABBA, but what was like the first thing that made you think, hey, there's more to this than just this, you know, baby sound?
Oh, I don't know about the first, but I know that, you know, there's something to be said about pop music in general when I consider the position of not just pop, but when you have something that you're putting out to the world And there's kind of like there's a superficial layer to it that's kind of the go-to assumption, like when people come across something. And ABBA is one of those bands that when you start to listen to particularly the lyrical content, you'll notice that there's various themes. And some of them, upon deeper inspection, turn out to be quite subversive for what is taken to just be like a simple pop song. You know, there's a depth to the lyrical content, but then there's also just looking at dates and strange anomalies. So if I don't know which one we want to jump into first, if we want to go through the discography and look at the corresponding synchronicities, or if I want to talk about what, you know what, you asked me a question, so maybe I should just go there in terms of like what set me off in this direction.
Yeah, I'd love to hear your personal, like the first spot, and we can then go into the discography, because at some point you studied it all in depth from the beginning to the end. But like, what started it, you know?
It was about a week before I was born was the release of ABBA's last album, The Visitors. And so, you know, I was born December 8th, 1981, I believe. When was the Visitors released in 1981? It was November 30th. So I guess it's a little, you know, that's about maybe 8 days, right? 9 days. Wow. And so.
And it's my favorite ABBA album also.
Is it? Oh, nice. It's my favorite ABBA album as well. I mean, I celebrate their whole catalog, don't get me wrong.
Oh, yeah, yeah. But I listened to it all summer in Spain in my car. Like, I definitely listened to that album a few more times than the rest of them.
Okay, so if you've seen Sorry, Cassandra, you know that that film actually centers around a film called The Visitor. When The Visitor first came out, it was actually, the original posters actually said The Visitors. So you have, you know, that's 1980, I believe. So you have November 21st, 1980 was the release of in America.
It's supposed to be Italian, right?
There's a lot of weird things about it. First of all, the director of it, you know, he hadn't done American films before. He didn't do American films before this or after this. So this is like his one film filmed in America, and he's got like an all-star cast. You got
like a weird fake name, right? Like he's
using an alias that's Michael J. Paradise. And
Paradise.
And the Paradise part is completely left field. I'd have to look it up again. This is all stuff that I was looking at a few years ago, so feel free to cross-reference, and you'll see if I say something that's slightly inaccurate, you'll see I'm not purposely manipulating. You can go and see why.
Because
like right now I'm like, was it the Michael J part that wasn't related to his name, or was it the other? But anyway, fact is that it was an alias. And what I found really interesting is that the release date of this film, The Visitor, was the same day and year as the second biggest hotel fire in America, the MGM Grand Casino. Mm. The MGM Grand was constructed in the style of kind of like a Mayan pyramid, like the way it goes up. Now that was the second biggest hotel fire in U.S. history. The first biggest hotel fire in U.S. history was the Wyckoff Hotel, and that was December 7th, 1946.
And these were like the September 11th of the time that everyone knew somebody who knew somebody who was in this, you know, was in Vegas or during some kind of these fires, man.
Right. So what's totally bizarre is that this film, The Visitor, that's released the same day and year as the MGM Grand fire in Paradise, California, even though you say it's Vegas, but it's technically Paradise. So that's kind of strange. I'm like, okay, so this film is released the same day and year as this fire that took place in Paradise, Nevada. The guy who made the film goes by the alias Michael J. Paradise, which is so funny. Like, it obviously calls to mind, at least for me, Back to the Future, where I'm like, oh, Michael J. Fox, so Michael J. Paradise. But anyway.
Yeah, and Paradise is kind of like Pleasure Palace. It seems like the same kind of sink, yeah.
Oh, totally. So we can go there. I mean.
Oh, please. I mean, like, Paradise, Giulio or whatever his name is, the guy who was the Roman filmmaker behind that movie, his name means like emperor, it's a Persian influenced name, and paradise and garden and emperor are all like Persian Sumerian root. So to be an emperor is to be a gardener of the people.
Sure. Interesting. Yeah. And then even the meaning of the visitors in both the film and the album are completely correspondent. And so when we're relating to what are the visitors, are we speaking to something clefotic? Are we talking about aliens? What are we speaking to? Is it angels? Is it demons? You know what I mean? Like, it's the album, obviously, you know, speaking the song, The Visitors, saying I've been waiting for these visitors to come, you know, and it's so resonant with the story of the visitor. But so looking at this, so 119 people died at the Wyckoff Hotel in 1946. This was in Atlanta, Georgia. So this fire happens with the MGM Grand, same day and year that The Visitor is released. The film The Visitor pivots around the location of this hotel in Atlanta. It's even in one of the opening shots of the film. It's actually in the center of the screen. And so I had friends from Atlanta that I sent screenshots to, and I said, do you see the Wyckoff Hotel in this picture? And they're like, yes, this is in the center screen. So I'm like, okay, well, that's interesting that you'd have the site of the first biggest hotel fire showing up in this film that was released the same day and year as the second biggest hotel fire. Also, just all the things around these fires, it's like they changed the code for what, you know, for how to deal with fire safety because of this fire in 1946. Now, a lot of those measures were like ignored with the construction of the MGM Grand. And maybe it's the style of the way that the place was built with its slant, a pyramid type slant or something, you know, but most people died in their rooms. A lot of people died in their beds and there was no alarm that went off. It's questionable how the fire was even started. They speculated that it was from a grease fire in the kitchen below, but that's none of that is proven. We don't really know. It's just there's a lot of suspicious elements on it.
They've also talked about how everything was plastic, and so everything melted so quickly that it was just like it was one of the fastest fires.
It went up really fast. Yes, it's you know, the place was engulfed in flames, and so you can find things like, you know, in the future, like Lady Gaga performing at the MGM Grand and just having a whole fire theme where fire's coming out of her piano and shit. It's just like, you know, it's definitely she's referencing that. So it's a thing in American history, you know, that a lot of people, you know, unless you're around in 1980, you've probably forgotten about or not aware of, but it was a big deal at the time, right? And so this set me on this whole, you know, fixation. But then I did the obvious thing for myself, considering my background of 20 years of pairing, or at this point, I guess close to 25 years of pairing albums with films. I was like, why not take The Visitors and pair it with The Visitor, you know? And what I got out of that was, you know, what I consider something extraordinary. And that's why I included it at the center of the Sarah Cassandra film. But yeah, so I'm on this whole chain with that. This leads me to Waterloo.
Most Americans, I don't think, have actually even seen Waterloo. And then at the same time, ABBA has a song, Waterloo. It's a pop song about Waterloo.
Yeah. Obviously, if you pair Waterloo with Waterloo, it's off the charts. And there's a lot of things going on there where it seems like there's kind of like people have picked up on this without looking at ABBA. But when you pair ABBA with it, it's just compounded, right? So, like, you know, there seems to be a sub-communication. A couple years ago, I went to the Stanley Kubrick archives at Elephant and Castle, and I got a few days of being able to, you know, I looked through every single available document relating to Kubrick's Napoleon film. And in those documents were included, you know, letters from people asking him if he was aware of this film Waterloo that was being produced at the same time. And Kubrick has a history of this. Like, he's working on Aryan Papers, a film about the Holocaust, and then you have, you know, Spielberg coming up with Schindler's List, you know, and it's like, that's the explanation for why that film didn't come out. But this one is a little odd, because you have, you know, so much behind it. He's scouting locations, he's doing all this work, it's something he's really passionate about, and then MGM... it said, I couldn't find any, this is one of the main things I was looking for in those archives. I wanted to find actual evidence of MGM turning down his project. because I question that. I don't know. I'm not saying anything.
Yeah, I didn't see that either. What I noticed, though, similar to you, when I was at the Copenhagen Kubrick exhibit, they have the, when they bring the exhibit, they have the Dewey Decimal Systems, like, library book with cue cards, like 4x6 cards. There's, like, thousands of every single moment of that film planned already.
Yeah, but I read every card that was in the archives, and I handled every card wearing gloves. You know, I was so tempted to just slide one in my pocket.
But you saw Aladdin as a kid. I'm really proud of you.
Thank you. Yeah, no, it's not my style. It's not my style to do that. But I have to admit that there was a few notes and things that I was like, really, this, like, I'm handling this. So it would be unethical of me. But anyway, so, you know, I'm looking at this and I'm like, well, you know, this is, the timing is just impeccable of him preparing for this film and then dropping the film and then production starting, I believe within 3 months. I'd have to check that, but I believe it was within 3 months that from the time of him saying to dropping the project, production starting for this film Waterloo. And so I got curious about who wrote Waterloo, like, because, you know, Kubrick had 1,000 scripts of screenplays that never came to fruition, you know, and I'm wondering, did he have some part in this? Is there something, you know, something more than meets the eye here? And so I just get into this, looking into this guy, Hal Craig, HAL Craig. And he's just the most bizarre character. I went on there a couple times and discussed this. But the first time that I went on there and I went off about this Hal Craig guy, within like a week of giving this whole rant and telling people, hey, look up this guy's Wikipedia page. Within a week of that, all his Wikipedia was removed. His page was gone. Not only that, but every sentence in every film that he contributed to that related to him was removed from those pages as well.
Yeah, if you have an account on Wikipedia, you can actually look at a timeline and see the edits.
Oh, awesome.
But they've done a big thing where a lot of the time they've removed pages completely, and they're really hard to find and scout for pages that were, like, you know, names of people that they think are no longer important.
But the German is still available. Thing is, so I just, even just before this interview, I just popped up some tabs just, you know, for reference. And I'm looking at the German, and I swear it's like a quarter of the size that it used to be.
Had Capricorn 1 scenes in it, and the doctor who tells everyone that the moon landing was faked by filmmakers is played by a guy named Hal Holbrook.
Oh, yes. There's a lot of strange things there with the Hal. There's also, like, you know, obviously it's each one letter removed from IBM. You can see in Arthur C. Clarke's book where he discusses that, says he was gifted a computer by Macintosh after the release of 2001 A Space Odyssey, and he looked at what the probability would be for it to land that way, and it's actually exactly 6 cubed, the probability for it to be each one. And then I think that there's this kind of arrogance from Arthur C. Clarke that he thinks he was privy to everything. You know, he was just like, oh, yeah, surely Kubrick would have told me if that was the thing, because, you know, we're so buddy-buddy. And it's like,
yeah, so what do you think about that? Like, after years of looking at that relationship, like, what's up with Arthur C. Clarke? And, you know, I mean, by the way, the director of Capricorn 1, he was the director of 2010, which Arthur C. Clarke had more say over. Kubrick had taken over 2001 and made it his way. And so Arthur C. Clarke really had, like, they had like a disagreement in some respects, supposedly.
Right. It's kind of like the thing with Stephen King, except Stephen King wasn't involved in The Shining. And so here you have, he's doing the same thing as he did with Stephen King, Kubrick, but he's having to navigate somebody right there alongside him, feeling like he's on the same page. You know, and I think a lot of that was almost, you know, like placation or something. There was something.
Well,
weird.
That also helps because of that. What's that movie about Maximum Overdrive? It's like the first Stephen King's movie he directed himself about trucks that take over.
Oh, one of the greatest films ever made.
Absolutely.
You're a fan of AC/DC. You'll love it. Yeah.
I like and Shorty Shorts that you made from Daisy Dukes. But right. if you take that movie and watch it and then you erase that psychologically from The Shining, then you get Kubrick, and then you start to understand, like, all the littler symbols. That was at a time when we started noticing that all of the symbols that Kubrick, he was taking symbols and putting them into book-based movies that were completely different than the way the books were intended to be. And a lot of people say, oh, well, movies are so different.
He started with subtext first. And we have evidence for this with Dr. Strangelove and Full Metal Jacket in particular, where that was openly admitted, you know, not in a big public forum, but in letter correspondences with people. And so, for example, we know from that Vanity Fair interview when I think it's Michael Herr is speaking to Kubrick, calling him up and asking him if he's familiar with Carl Jung's notion of the shadow. And he says they discuss the shadow for about, I think, 30 minutes or something. And then Kubrick says, I really want to get this concept into my next film. Do you know of any good war books? And what you can extrapolate from that is he hasn't even decided on what the story is. He hasn't even decided on what it is that he's adapting, already got the subtext that he wants to incorporate. And when you watch Full Metal Jacket, you can totally see that, because you don't see the enemy, the Viet Cong, until the very last scene. They're always in shadow, they're always veiled, and then it turns out to be a woman at the end, the sniper at the end. And then there's kind of a symbolic gangbang, because they're and this is a really good opener for where I wanted to go with this. Because what do we see with the subtext in Full Metal Jacket speaking to repression and sublimation? And basically, like, you know, this kind of I don't know it's like the way that the Marine Corps in particular in Full Metal Jacket, the way that they get the young soldiers to take what the energy that they would be putting into getting laid and putting it into their kills, so that getting a kill is the equivalent of getting laid. So you're basically, they have all this vitality, and then they want to direct that vitality into the opposite of sex, which is murder. So, you know, sex is a creative act. Murder is the opposite, right? So it's kind of like substitute reality works best when you're dealing with opposites, which is actually a Kabbalistic idea relating to the Kleepo mirroring tetragrammaton. But, you know, I think the same thing is true for Dr. Strangelove, and that one as well is openly admitted in a letter from Kubrick, where somebody was inquiring over the sexual subtext of Dr. Strangelove, and he says, yes, it's true from the opening to the beginning. What happens in the opening when they're fueling the plane, you know, very, if you watch closely and you consider that, it's symbolic, but even like then, and then you have the general who's so concerned about the communist plot for the, you know, he's like, I don't deny.
He doesn't want to lose his bodily fluids.
My bodily fluids, right? So he's not giving it up. He's like, I don't deny women, but I do deny them my seed. So he's still got this pent up repression.
It's bigger than anal retention is the tantric repression.
Sure, which we could go into people's obsession with toilet paper right now, you know, or at least recently, you know, it's like,
is that not just for mummification later? What were
you? Oh, interesting. No, I was just speaking to, you know, Freud's notion of anality and how it might relate.
Humanly speaking, there are a lot of Freuds around here these days. You know what I mean? Like, I've seen that.
You have the atomic bomb at the end is basically, okay, now they're getting it on, but everything's in reverse. So what would be, like, if you're relating to America and Russia basically being like these two frustrated individuals that won't just, you know, make love, they need to make war, you know? So that's the idea, at least. And so that one's admitted. Full Metal Jacket's admitted.
Something Kubrick had chosen as the reason why there's a kind of Dr. Strangelove, like a educated Strangelove. And that different kind of love, because there's a bunch of different words that Greeks used for love, and now we have one. But there's probably this additional kind of strange love, which is an affection for humanity, which is teaching them through strictness. It's like, you don't understand, so I'm going to beat you with it.
Right. It's just, you see this subtext in Waterloo, and people have commented on it beyond, you know, the pairing that I'm doing, which really emphasizes the point when you take Waterloo and pair it with Waterloo. But there's this kind of, you know, extremely like pent up homosexual thing going on between the Duke of Wellington and Napoleon throughout that whole film. And the way that it's shot with the back and forth, where you see like Napoleon looking out the window and it's raining, the way it cuts to, you know, the Duke of Wellington by candlelight, and even when they're out on the field, and it's just, it's really driven home. And so you have, like, I consider Waterloo a concept album about Napoleon all the way through, but not just about Napoleon, but like literally relating to like Kubrick's fascination with Napoleon and how that translates into what he's communicating through his films. So it sounds really out there, you know, but there's grounds for it. What are the grounds for that? What do we hear? We hear what about Livingston? So there's the song, What About Livingston, in the album Waterloo. And what is What About Livingston is about? Livingston discovered the source of the Nile, right? So you have, not that it, from their standpoint, you know. So you have this explorer. And so the song is I guess it's Anita walking up to the people at the newspaper stand. And they're joking about, oh, why should we go to the moon? What's the point? You know, what's the point of all that anyway? And she comes up and she makes this argument of what about Livingston? And she's like, you know, talking about the sacrifice. And she's like, all the sacrifice that went into this thing. And it's like, wait a minute, are you talking about colonization is your argument for why we should go to the moon? Because that's how it translates with Livingston. So it's just, when you listen to that song, it's so applicable to like Arthur C. Clarke and Kubrick's trip on like what like 2001 was an advertisement for, you know, to get us pumped up for the space race, you know. And it's, there's so much public relations involved in 2001: A Space Odyssey. I mean, the original credits, lots of people can account this who saw in the theater in 1968, was that the credits supposedly were like twice as long and included lots of military officials and NASA employees, you know. And so, you know, obviously NASA used to be a military organization. I don't have to tell you all about that and Project Paperclip and all of these things. But there's huge implications in terms of what's being communicated around how artificial intelligence. It gets to a point where you're like, is this just absolute precogging? Like, what the hell? You know, I mean, look at what Apple has done using 2001: A Space Odyssey for its advertising. Like, it's out of control. Like, I went to the Apple place to get my computer worked on a few years back, and it was like it was everything on the televisions was just 2001 and playing on the monolith being like the iPhone, you know, it's this whole thing. And so basically, like, what I see when I look at Waterloo, and which is like really pushed, which is emphasized by the album, is this subtext of repression and sublimation. And it's like, you know, there's a song of the boys on the playground that don't want the girls to come and play with them because they're busy being boys on the playground, you know. And it's like, you couldn't come up with more applicable lyrics to what's happening in that scene, you know. It's just really poignant. And so, you know, I'm researching that, and I'm like, okay, well, this Hal Craig guy, like, what the hell? And I'm looking at his background and stuff, and I'm digging a little deeper, and I find that this guy produced two films within 3 days of each other in 1977. So you have on March 9th, 1977, you have the release of this film, which ended up being called The Message. Originally, it was called Muhammad, Messenger of God. What seems really strange about it is that there's indication that it was almost like a provoking, like he was like provoking with that film, because it's like, you know damn well, like he wrote a book on the birth of Islam, Hal Craig. It's the only book I can find that he wrote. And it's like, okay, so this is obviously an interest of him, even if it is this, not his actual name. Maybe it's a composite of different people doing, I don't know if it's just a cover name for various writers. I'm not really sure. Or he could be a real guy and he exists, but it's just, there's elements, like you can't find his picture on the internet. If you go to look at IMDb, I believe now they got like a picture with three different people or four different people. It's hard to tell which one is actually him, but beside the point. Anyway, yeah, so this film about the birth of Islam resulted in a siege on Washington, where there was 149 hostages, a radio journalist was killed. It was a big time news thing in 1977, right? And so I'm like, this is over the release of this very controversial film. Muhammad isn't shown in the film, but when you present a film that you're releasing and you call it Muhammad, Messenger of God, the last thing people are going to be thinking is that Muhammad isn't in it. You know what I mean? That's why I say it almost has this kind of like provocation to it. You know, it's like, what? Why would you do that? So the siege lasted from March 9th to March 11th, where these 149 hostages were kept. So what's strange is this was over the release date of his film, which was March 9th, 1977. So March 11th, 1977, was the release of another Hal Craig written film called Airport 77. It's like a couple of writers. He's one of them. So I'm looking at him like, this guy didn't write that many films. you know. So what are the chances that with, like, bookending this siege, one released on the 9th, one released on the 11th, the first one about Islam, the second one about a plane hijacking by terrorists. And so, first of all, I mean, I shared this on your show before. We've had this conversation where I did this, like, quick rundown. But when we had that conversation, I don't believe I included the next thing. So that was already blowing my mind. But I just got curious. I was like, what did anything happen of significance on March 10th, 1977? Because I'm looking at these two dates and I'm like, these are bookending the siege and they're bookending the release of these two Hal Craig films. Did anything happen on the 10th? What I stumbled upon when I looked that up was that the biggest concert to be called off up to that point, maybe now, I don't know, in rock and roll history was an ABBA concert. A bomb threat on the 10th of March, and I believe it was Australia. And I'm like, so what are the chances? Like, because understand, like, from my perspective, like, I'm already approaching this with, you know, looking at the lens of Waterloo and Hal Craig's being the sole writer of Waterloo. And I'm like, is this like a Kubrick film? Am I looking at, not to say that Kubrick made it, but did he have any part in the writing of this Waterloo film? Because it has his signature subtext that he used in both Dr. Strangelove and Full Metal Jacket. And it seems to be incorporated into the thing and then it's driven home by ABBA. So what the hell, when I stumble upon, wait a minute, ABBA had a bomb threat on the day that I'm looking for any significant event and that's what I get? Like, okay, very peculiar.
3 weeks ago, the Waterloo police were investigating a bomb threat posted online and it was all about COVID-19. And there was a number of little sinks to that, but it was on the St. Paddy's Day thing where the snakes were supposed to arrive. And so wow. I just felt like there was a lot of synchronicities there.
I'm like, okay, so it's literally an example of what the hell are the chances. So then beyond that, I'm like, okay, well, what album was ABBA touring in 1977? What was their 1977 album? Well, it's called ABBA the Album. Not to be confused with self-titled ABBA, which is another album, which is earlier, right? So take check a chance it out, on me. Dude. Yeah, take a chance on me. Yes, thank you. And Like an Eagle, which is the super, okay, I could, thank you for the music, all this stuff. But anyway, if you take ABBA, the album, if you take the album and you start at the minute, the second that the frame that the message starts, the movie, The Message, first frame of the film, it will do exactly four rounds and end the second that the movie ends. Exactly. Four complete rounds.
So when you start it, you start the
first second frame? That the movie starts, it does a pop in, right? Yeah.
Wow.
So it goes instant to the instant, four rounds. Two albums I did in a row with that. The other one's King Kong. So if you take the 1976 King Kong, obviously the year before, and you play it with the 1976 album Arrival from ABBA, it'll do the exact same thing.
There's a bit of goth.
I'm a Marinette.
Yeah, there's a bit.
She's a puppet on a string. What are they talking about? It seems so fucking subversive. And I'm like, and I could go into the levels of it if we wanted, like, you know, if we were like watching the thing through, I could point out a million things. But I just want to point this out that you have this four round phenomenon. The obvious thing for me to do as a type of filmmaker that I am working with video collage is when I see that four round phenomenon, it makes me want to cut the film and make four boxes to watch the four rounds at once of where the music would happen to land if it was just allowed to play through. So instead of watching, you know, it round by round, I want to watch all those rounds together.
Like in the Back to the Future, he watches a number of films and channels at the same time. David will synchronize, like the way people synchronize albums, a number of movies at the same time. It's kind of like a video tarot card deck.
Yeah, well, I do a number of other type of experiments too. Like if you saw, like, what is it? The Ghost Rider, Polanski's film, not Ghost Rider. Okay, not Nicolas Cage. Ghost Writer.
Why do we always have to say not Nicolas Cage?
I have to say that.
Yeah, I say every day.
Well, I'm not putting down Nicolas Cage. I'm just saying, just so we know what we're talking about. So you have The Ninth Gate, another Polanski film. The Ninth Gate has an intro where it moves through nine gates. If you take Ghost Writer and you start at the second that the Ninth Gate opens in the intro of the credits of The Ninth Gate, then the two films will cut to credits at the exact same time. And one film, The Ninth Gate, shows fire through the credits. You see these flames. And then with Ghost Writer, you see the credits are all written in the style of CIA documents. So it looks as though when you're watching them together, the documents are on fire, which is how the movie ends, with is with the documents, the guy's, what do you call it, autobiography or whatever, being scattered, that revealed an acrostic to communicate that the man's wife was an assassin for the CIA, which then reflects, this is complicated, I did an always record thing about this, I don't know if I need to lay it all out, but there's a, you know, with the Ninth Gate, that is, that movie comes from a book called Club Dumas. I might be pronouncing that wrong, but anyway, it's a fictional book that contains a fictional book that's referencing an actual book that is described as a dream within a dream. And so that actual book that it's all based on from 1499, published 1499, Club Dumas was published in, or no, The Ninth Gate was released in 1999. But this this book that it ties into actually contains an acrostic that reveals the writer's name in the same style that Polanski used in Ghost Writer. And so both are relating to this acrostic, but it does it in this really unusual way. So they're tied together. There's a phenomenon with Polanski where he'll go back and forth between, okay, now we're talking witchcraft, now we're talking CIA or MKUltra, like Death and the Maiden, you know, where you have this back and forth, CIA witchcraft, CIA witchcraft. I want to get into Crowley's involvement with the sinking of the Lusitania. It's like, if you compare the timeline that's given in that book, it's just this idea where you're like, when people are relating to what is magic, and there's a lot of assumptions around that, and a lot of it is, you know, not as simple as potato farming, which is how Crowley would describe it. You know, where he's like, you do something, you don't, how are you supposed to know that this will wield these results? You might not know how or why, but it does. You know,
got a bunch of Bolivians just scoffed at us all.
Oh, I'm sure.
Let's get into the RMS Lusitania. Like 1915, German U-boat 11 miles off the southern coast of Ireland killed 1,200 passengers.
If you look at Crowley's involvement in magic, and then you look at what's actually been disclosed about his involvement in British intelligence and playing multiple sides during that event, you can kind of get an idea of how, you know, what he's relating to as magic.
Germans justified threatening Lusitania as a naval vessel because she's carrying hundreds of tons of war ammunition, making her a legitimate military target. Later, they found out that it had become part of the submarine service system, the British introduction of the Q ships, capital Q dash ships, in 1915, the Q ships with concealed deck guns. So the Q ships, there was an organization called the Q-boat, the decoy vessels, special service ships, mystery ships, the Q-ships, which were heavily armed merchant ships with concealed weaponry. And these Q-ships happened to get away with a lot during a time when they were supposed to be, you know, not in war because of war treaties. But instead, what they had was they had to defend themselves against supposed pirates. So they had very serious artillery. And then they had unrestricted submarine warfare. So the amount of commercial submarines in 1915 were probably higher, I mean, at least, you know, as they are today.
But, right. A lot of immigrants came in on the Lusitania, including Kubrick's relatives. I mean, it was a common boat to dock into New York, and so that's where he ended up. But, you know, this dividing the screen into four screens, I didn't know when I did that if you look up the songs from that album called ABBA the Album, that they do the four screen thing throughout these music videos, where you see the four characters of ABBA being relayed through these four screens, and then ABBA itself as a mirror when you're looking at the two B's facing away from each other as the two men in the group with the two women on both sides, right? And so that's Abba is Hebrew for father. If this is going to tie into something else. So if you look at Abba the movie, which came out in 1977, there's actually one scene where a man actually points this out. I don't know if he's Jewish, but he's pointing out that he's like, hey, isn't it interesting that Abba translates as father in Hebrew, which would relate to Chokhmah on the Kabbalistic tree, right? So you have Abba and Ima. Ima would be mother, so that would be Bina, when you're looking at the Kabbalistic tree, you're looking at literally like what is supposed to be one, which has been divided or at least polarized into these two sides. It's opening. It's like palms opening, right? So you're looking at these two sides of the thing. It's like encoded into the freaking logo for Abba that it's the Father recreating himself, just like, you know, Eve comes from the rib of Adam. So, you know, it's all there. It's so bizarre. And so, you know, I guess I just the fact that you can do what you can do. So Abba the movie, 1977. Album Abba the album, 1977. The message, 1977. You have the movie, the album, the message. Here's the topical level. Here's the album. Here's Muhammad, Messenger of God, renamed The Message, pairing with the album to like the ultimate degree. And then I'm like, well, what is actually being communicated through that? And there is a communication that happens through that. And it's very bizarre. So Abba's first album was titled Ring Ring. In 1973, the year that it came out, the two biggest things to come out of Sweden were this ABBA album, obviously, Ring Ring, and a film called, what is it called? It's a teenage nymphomaniac. Let me see if I can look this up. I should have had this pre-prepared.
Oh, right. Yeah. I've seen that one. That was sexy. The Swedish, yeah. Swedish film?
Nymphette, yeah, Swedish Nymphette or whatever, but it's
Swedish Nymphette, 1973, Anita.
Thank you. Which is actually apparently the same name as like you say. Anta.
Don't watch it, anybody. But yeah, it's steamy.
Don't watch it. What?
I'm just kidding. But yeah, some people shouldn't probably.
I mean, this would probably offend some people nowadays. Right? But it was a
young psychology student who meets this boy, Eric. It's a lot better than 50 Shades of Grey. Come on, do it. It's a Swedish classic.
Right. So you have Stellan Skarsgård is the character of the therapist with the young girl in Anita, right? He would go on to play the character in Lars von Trier's Nymphomaniac.
It's the same guy. Oh,
man,
I forgot that that's him because he's so young in that movie.
Right?
Oh, man, he's in all these other movies, too. He's Amistad, right. Good Will Hunting, everything. Nymphomaniac, right. Though.
If you know the ending of that film with her, salvation, where they go to the church and she's with this guy of Stellan Skarsgård, and now they're together and she's reconciled her nymphette issues, whatever. Okay. He's hooking up with her after, like, it's because he believed in her. He's in love with her. He'll go through any, you know, go through this whole thing. And so it turns out to be this whole love story. Well, you got the same guy doing the same thing with Charlotte Gainsbourg in Nymphomaniac. How does it end? With, oh, but you fucked 1,000 men. Bang, bang. She shoots him dead. He's doing the same thing as he did
absolutely
in the Swedish Nymphette. I believe in you so much. What is it? So it's kind of like, it's this classic statement from Trier that he actually repeats throughout his films. It's even like Breaking the Waves. It's really the same message, but just taken to another level. But really, as far as I can tell, he is directly playing off of this 1973 film, which in and of itself has its own significance. But then when you pair it with ABBA, Ring Ring. So what's the first shot of Anita, Swedish Nymphette, is actually a pool table and somebody taking a shot at with the pool cue. And if you look closely at their hand, they're wearing the wedding ring, right? So you have the album is Ring Ring, like I'm waiting for that telephone call, but it's also communicating marriage, right? And so you have this like, what is it that determines that we're, you know, like a moral person or whatever, when we're projecting morality into sexuality, you know. And then that becomes the same question with that and that. But also, there's another film, Diary of a Teenage Girl. It's a weird title for what the movie actually is, but it's a 2015 movie, but it takes place in the 1970s in San Francisco, and it stars Alexander Skarsgård, his son. These people were actually my cousin's neighbors in Midborg Plotsen in Stockholm when he was growing up. But anyway, it continues to play on the same theme, this film, Diary of a Teenage Girl, and it does it at around the same time that the Anita was supposed to take place, or did take place. And so, yeah, no, it's just, it's very strange then that they would put another Skarsgård in there. I don't think it's an accident. I think it's archetype casting, but.
Well, think about what Skarsgård, you remember what he did with the other ABBA movie he was in.
What's the other ABBA
movie? He's in Mamma Mia. He's in 2003's version of Mamma Mia.
That's right.
Yeah. So, yeah. I mean, or 2008 or whatever, he plays Bill in Mamma Mia.
That's right.
So I think that's a little too much. There's too much synchronicity not to be a bit more correlated.
Right. I mean, you're like Sweden. Okay, there's an attraction there. But like this film takes place in San Francisco. This isn't, and Nymphomaniac isn't. You know, I mean, obviously, you know, it's.
We were talking earlier about The Visitors. What is the producer of The Visitors? As Ovid, what's his name?
Oh, yes.
He produced Amistad. Amistad's directed by Steven Spielberg, Kubrick's, secretary, whatever you want
to say. Right, who would go on to do AI.
And who plays Tappan in Amistad, but Skarsgård, right after Good Will Hunting, at the same time as he's doing Good Will Hunting. So, I mean, is there something to Good Will Hunting in the fact that he's in Amistad? But the one that really got me that Skarsgård is doing right now and is coming out in 2020, is coming this year, is Dune. Because the new Dune has Skarsgård as Baron Vladimir Harkonnen, the big guy, you know, in Dune.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, and he's like the guy with boils on his face and the good one, the 80s Dune.
Sure.
It's gonna be pretty interesting that Skarsgård is gonna play the house of the Atreides, kind of the antithesis of the antagonist family in the Dune series, you know, fighting against this kind of Jesuit drug runners that run the desert planet.
I see. Very interesting. Yeah, I saw Mamma Mia in London, the actual production, and it was so bad it was good, is I guess what you could say.
That's usually how it works.
My experience, yeah. I mean, it's you're not, if I'm not watching ABBA perform ABBA, it's never going to be. It's also like, if I want to see Anne Freed, like, you know, with all the her background and everything that's going along with it, you know, the irony of being persecuted for being a eugenics baby. And then you're like, okay, well, which is the same thing with von Trier. So what his interest would be, especially at that point, because we're talking post Antichrist, after he found out that the man who he thought was his father his whole life wasn't actually his father, and that his father was actually a Nazi composer. He basically had an identity crisis, because even though it wasn't his mother who was Jewish, he identified with a part of himself as being Jewish. And he finds out, not only am I not Jewish, and it's hard to relate to Steven Spielberg now, you know, and this whole, the Hollywood scene as far as that goes, but he's like, oh my God, I'm actually like, my mother had a baby for the creative genes. The irony is really intense with ABBA band member Anne Freed being related to, is like, you know, discriminated against for being born through the eugenics program.
Both sides, because you can't be Jewish.
But what
you're
became
not accepted into it? So you're neither one. You're outside of both. You know.
Sure. It's like, you know, my cousins who are half black and half white. You know, you're because they're older than me, and what they had to deal with growing up, you know, it was really challenging in that way. When you have, you know, you're not going to be accepted by them. You're not going to be accepted by them. Well, then what the hell? And so, you know, but so we go 1973, Ring Ring. It's a solid pairing. With Anita, the teenage nymphette, right? Swedish nymphette, whatever. Second album that they ever released was Waterloo.
Like, People Need Love, She's My Kind of Girl. Like, I mean, He's Your Brother. Like, I don't know.
Right.
The songs on Ring Ring really go for it. Like, it really is kind of clearly about nymphette exploration.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, I could go on, but it's like, with that album, you're like, the railway station, when she says, I guess I'll live my life in railway stations. That's what's happening in the movie, because she's been marked as a slut where she's at in Stockholm. And so she has to go take the train to like freaking Gothenburg to get, you know, to get her action, because now she's been demonized. And so
Why do you think Merry-Go-Round was taken off of the American version? You know, like what's up with the Merry-Go-Round song that they took off the album? Is that important?
What their rationale was? I'm not sure.
Do you do the synchronization with it or without it? Which version do you use?
I use it. Absolutely.
Yeah, totally.
Anything that I do, I always go to like, what is the closest to the original? I have a frequent problem with Blu-ray films. So like when they re-release films, they'll often time stretch them. It just came up for me last night looking at Boy on a Dolphin, which I've been working on for like a month with Leonard Cohen's debut album, because it was filmed in Hydra shortly before he wrote the whole album in Hydra in Greece. And the film will be elongated. And I'm like, and sometimes they'll do just like a couple changes with little scenes here and there. Like that happened when they did a Blu-ray of Waterloo. So when I have to not only find one older version, I have to find another older version. So say I find an AVI, I want to find another MP3 that isn't the Blu-ray and see to make sure if the two match. Because when you're encoding films, sometimes the timing can be a little different. I want the technical, what was the timing when this film was released, you know? And so I have to imitate that sometimes. So the only time that I'll ever stretch a film is when I'm stretching a Blu-ray inward and making sure I have multiple copies of the original to verify that this is in fact the exact length to the second of the original film. And so like I'm super rigid on that because I need, and so it's the same thing applies to albums. I want the closest thing to what was the original conception. I don't want some deluxe edition with special songs or whatever, unless if I'm pairing it with a newer film and then the special songs, it turns out, came out like right after the film or something, you know what I mean? Like then I might include them, you know, at least as the experiment and see how it plays out, you know? But yeah, that happened with Waterloo. I had to find multiple versions of the film in order to cross-reference to make sure what I was doing was justified in order to stretch it inward to match that original timing, which means that I'm looking at two films with the top one with 50-50 transparency until they match in complete unison. You see what I'm saying?
People want to buy the longest version of a movie.
I think they do it. I think that they're time stretching films, and then your naked eye won't pick it up. Like, which movie do I want to get? And then you see this one is like 3 minutes longer, 10 minutes longer. You're probably going to go with the one that's longer, even if all they did was elongate it and didn't change a damn thing other than stretching it. Going along the discography here, we've covered Ring Ring for the most part. We can talk about it again if we want. Waterloo, we've covered in part. Next album, 1975, is ABBA. So when I was saying before, you have ABBA, the album. Not to be confused with self-titled ABBA, right? So this album, I was researching, I was like, so this, there's a, I was looking at Hal Craig films, and I'm like, okay, was there a Hal Craig film that came out in 1975? But see, this is the thing. I'm thinking to myself, what are the emphasized elements in ABBA, ABBA's self-titled? One of them is paradise, desert island. I'm like, it should be something relating to a desert island. There's a theme in the album that it comes back to. And I'm just, at the same time as I'm thinking that, I'm like, what did Hal Craig produce in 1975? I come across a film called The Other Side of Paradise. And it had two alternative titles. It had Foxtrot and The Other Side of Paradise. This film was never released in the US ever. You can get DVDs or whatever from overseas, but it had no official US release, which is very odd because it has such an all-star cast. And so it's an incredible pairing. I highly recommend checking it out. I have it online. The idea of the premise in the movie is these people. It has Max von Sydow in there. Who ended up living in Sweden, but wasn't originally from Sweden, right? But he is still related to, for, you know, because of that, as a Swedish actor. The style of the garb that people wear in that film is very resonant with the style of ABBA at that time, with the white hats and the white outfits. It's very, you know, a certain age, because the movie, though it comes out in the 1970s, it's relating to the 1940s during World War II, where these very rich people would take their yachts out away from everything. They're like, okay, so there's conflict in the world. We're going to go off and we're going to do our own things on this desert island because we're so rich we can escape all of this. But then everything can basically breaks down and they end up at each other's throats. And it's just this, you know, so that's why it's called The Other Side of Paradise, right?
Hall Craig is this sort of anonymous character that it's very hard to find any information on, especially after you look and they delete all the information you've already found. But what's, you know, looking at Kubrick, whom, you know, made this movie about IBM, and he's made, you know, this, I mean, using HAL because the next three letters, and he's also got a house when he makes NASA lens based candlelit films for
Barry Lyndon, you mean?
Barry Lyndon.
Yeah, yeah.
He made this British film that's kind of like the Johnny Depp Libertine that Malkovich made, but less sexy, but very interesting, and it's important. But this name, Hal Craig, right? So Craig is a Gaelic word. It's a Gaelic word that means stone, but it has a lot to do with like the scone stone that Isaac's son Jacob's ladder. He puts his head upon the scone stone. All British crown has ever to have been crowned has to do it upon the scone stone. They have to sit on the stone. They think is the pillow from Jacob's ladder.
Oh yeah, or you can get into the Ben. Of the Kaaba.
The other funny thing is that the Gaelic word for stone is egg.
Hal Craig has, according to Wikipedia, has a twin brother named Dick. Totally rings of Mad Men, where you had, you know, Don Draper with his brother Dick. And why was he named Dick? Because his mother was a prostitute, and what did she say? While she was giving birth, she said she was going to boil the father's dick in pig fat. And then when the handmaiden comes, or the doula or whatever, she comes to bring the baby to the house of the guy who was more upper class, you know, she says, oh, his name is Dick. And then it's like, oh, because she said she's going to boil his dick in pig fat. And then the whole rest of the show, Mad Men, is basically like him acting as the maypole while he's getting on with all these different women, which is also just like his own process for his own nullification of the Kleepo, like till he ends up in Esalen at the end. That's a whole other thing to get into, but yeah, so it feels worth mentioning. I'm like, twin brother named Dick, really? He wrote speeches for the Queen, Hal Craig did. He wrote for a publication, but I couldn't find any of his articles. I looked and looked. I also was curious of which speeches of the Queen he had done. And then if you go to the actual website, that's like the official royal website where they give you all the speeches or whatever, it like wouldn't access me that one, and did a flippy thing where it was like bringing me to another speech. It's like hard to find. It's been a while, but I can't remember all the specifics around it. But yeah, there was some weirdness there. Anyway, yeah, the Other Side of Paradise. I mean, it reminds me of like Sitra Achra, or the Kleepo, The Other Side. This translates to The Other Side, like kind of like Poltergeist 2, The Other Side, you know. It's a, you know.
Craig and Crag. Crag is Kraken. Kraken, mm-hmm. You know, if you think about the other character that Sorsgord played, was the Kraken in the Pirates of the Caribbean with Johnny Depp from the Libertine. I love synchronicity.
Keep going. Yeah, my speculation, and I'm not going to say this in the authoritative manner, but my speculation is that Hal Craig is actually not just an alias for one person, but actually like a means for people to not associate themselves with a project. I mean, I'm just all I'm really saying is that I'm open to all kinds of possibilities.
Whom, with an M, would you think besides Kubrick could possibly be Hal Craig? It's very interesting. It's a very Sir Francis Bacon, Nancy Drew ghostwriter.
Well, what I'll tell you is that if you don't want to attach yourself to something, you know, I'm sure that Kubrick probably wouldn't be the only one.
I'm going to start saying that everything I do is produced by Hal Craig. I think that's a good
idea.
Yeah,
Well, I mean, that's just, it's the context, especially with Kubrick, where you're like, if you watch Kubrick's Boxes, you know, that John Ronson documentary, it's just like, it's so out of control how many things this guy wrote. And then I got to wonder, I'm like, there would probably be plenty of reason for him not to necessarily want to attach himself to a project, not necessarily out of it being controversial necessarily completely in every case. But I'm like, you know, it's when somebody writes that much, when they're that extremely prolific, and then when you see other things like what happened with like 007, The Spy That Loved Me, that he oversaw the cinematography of the final scenes of that movie, admitted by the director. You can watch those interviews with the director of The Spy That Loved Me, where he described it. And you can see the point where it shifts to Kubrick, because all of a sudden you have this, you know, the point perspective where it's his classic signature style, where now all of a sudden there's perfect symmetry, you know. And it maintains that way. And then it has this whole, and so that director has described how they moved other people off the set to bring in Kubrick to shoot this thing. And so I'm like, that is a case where it's like, Kubrick didn't want his name in the credits, you know, for that. I don't even think he used an alias in that case, because they already had their cinematographer and their lighting guys or whatever, you know, but he arranged the lighting, you know, and they had everything set up, and then they moved him off, and they brought people back in and whatever, you know, but like that happened. That's admitted. You know, I wonder the degree of it. I wonder with Hal Ashby, who did Harold and Maude and Being There, especially Peter Sellers' last film, which he died and came back to life for, you know, considered the most important film of his career, even more so than Dr. Strangelove. You know, he had a certain relationship to that. But then you see all the Kubrick references throughout the film with Thus Begs Zarathustra. But then also how Craig uses that symmetrical style. And I have to wonder what degree Kubrick may have been working with him, or if it's just an homage. It could just be an homage. That would probably be Occam's razor. But I'm just saying, I'm still open to other possibilities, you know.
There's a movie with Woody Allen about this, what's it called, where they're all writers that have been blacklisted. The Front, 1976, The Front.
I have not seen that Woody Allen film. Interesting.
My buddy, please check out Comrade, please. In 1976, a comedy drama film set against the Hollywood blacklist in 1950s communist-controlled California, where Stevenson, Adlai Stevenson, should have been president as far as most Californians were concerned. A number of Red Channel journalists were blacklisted and identified themselves as a front character. They paid an actor to be the writer that they were. And so five or six people, I think it's Zero, Mostel, Michael Murphy, Herschel Bernardi, Andrea Markovici, Ramak Ramsey, and Lloyd Gough. But there's women and men like Blavatsky and Lenin and et cetera. They have this sort of, you know, Jeremy Bentham, the idea that the Communist Manifesto and Das Kapital and et cetera were not written by just one person. Democles was not just one person. Voltaire, not just one person.
Sure, the gospel wasn't just one person.
Exactly.
But, you know,
exactly.
Yeah.
That it was named after a group of people, named after a person that came from a place, you know, sure. But after 100 years, a lot of people got to write the book. But the Shakespeare story is interesting. If you've seen Anonymous, it's a movie with Rhys Evans as the lover and relative of the Queen of England, I think Victoria.
Well, Shakespeare just, and the Francis Bacon thing, but it's just mainly, yeah, mainly P. Hall's The Secret Teachings of All Ages, his section in there. I've read
exactly.
That.
You get but, the yeah. idea that it's like you get an actor to play the writer so that you don't have to be the one who's in the front limelight, you know. And so this guy, Woody Allen, is playing a person behind a number of writers. And so Hal, like this idea of the hall, is kind of similar. There's a hall of stone, like Peter the Rock, there's a stone. And also stone being like, you know, Bernstein or, you know, Short Stone or something. It's like a stone. It might have something to do with
right
alchemy and, you know.
It's actually the opposite of what we saw with, like, a classic ghostwriter. So, like, you know that film I was talking about earlier, the Polanski film Ghostwriter with Ewan McGregor and Pierce Brosnan? Ewan McGregor is playing the ghostwriter of Pierce Brosnan, who's basically playing Tony Blair. So I joke that they could have called that movie the Tony Blair Witch Project. But basically, you know, you have somebody who's going to give the PR that's helpful for his image. So he's going through a book that he's actually written and adjusting it. What happened with Art of the Deal was that he literally had a ghostwriter not adjusting his own thing, but literally writing it. And then he attached his name to it. Same is true for his comeback book that no one ever seems to talk about, you know, But, you know, in this situation, you wouldn't have somebody who's wanting to take credit for something somebody else is doing, like with Ewan McGregor and Pierce Brosnan in that story, but you have somebody who's not wanting to be associated with this. And if you do, who's going to be the person to take credit for something that somebody else doesn't want to be associated with? That's when you need to come up with a full-on alias, you know. And so I speculate on this Hal Craig guy. I would be shocked if there was, you know, if there was nothing to it, because it's just, it's the syntax of how I got there. You know, I'm just like, that's just too much, you know.
I mean, the King's speech is, I mean, that's pretty, I mean, Queen's speech is, that's pretty incredible that this character has done a few nominal science fiction movies and a political history film and speeches. I mean, what? Like, that's,
yeah,
that's pretty specific stuff for someone to have done. A video, Gabriel Asinitis. He's the Egyptian-born, Greco-Italian entertainment executive film producer who did Beyond the Door, Tentacles, Piranha 2, The Spawning, and The Visitor. Do you think that there's something that we should look into about Aviv?
Yeah, it's interesting with Piranha 2, actually. As weird as it sounds, that was actually like Spielberg really liked Piranha. Like, that was, I guess Jaws came out before Piranha, didn't it? Or did it come out after? I don't know. I'd have to look that up. But I know that he had a special appreciation for Piranha. And, you know, it's like one of those that you'd want to see on, like, Mystery Science Theater,
I mean,
you know?
It's James Cameron's debut.
Piranha 2, really?
Yeah, Piranha 2, James Cameron, yeah.
Far out. That's really interesting. But what I would recommend is looking at that director, the director of The Visitor, and just what the hell to no other film. If you watch his other films, the spaghetti one or whatever, this, like, he did these kind of romantic comedy type things or whatever. None of them are in English. There is nothing. It's nothing remotely like The Visitor. I'm like, how the hell did this guy produce this, direct this, when nothing is any at all the same? Like, it's like a complete anomaly in his career. It makes zero sense. And so, you know, if you want to look into that, that would be a direction. So I mentioned it earlier, but we have Arrival. Actually, I'm not alone with this, but I sat in the helicopter that was on the cover of the album, right, at the ABBA Museum in Stockholm. Really cool place to check out. Highly recommend it. But, you know, the basis of my pairing Arrival and King Kong was just symbolism alone, you know, just like the helicopters take him out in that version at the two towers, at the top of the two towers, where he actually leaps from one tower to the other, which is extremely significant Kabbalistically, tying in Philippe Petit, might be pronouncing that wrong, but, you know, the Frenchman who tied the wire between the towers. And then we could get into Joe's video of Back to the Future and how it relates to Robert Zemeckis' later film, The Walk, which actually pairs perfectly with Leonard Cohen's album, Popular Problems, which just went down with my Vimeo, but I'll re-upload it. But yeah, so Arrival and King Kong, you have the song Arrival, the first time it plays in the pairing. Obviously, I said before that the album makes four exact rounds to the second. But the first time that it plays is the second that I believe it's the ship's captain touches the island. So they're, you know, King Kong, they arrive at this Skull Island or whatever. And when he sets foot on the island, that's when the symphonic song of Arrival starts. There's no lyrics to that song. It's just this really beautiful, epic, kind of like expansive, you know, composition. But the way that they shoot and they show the island with that whole thing, it justifies, I mean, not that that alone would need to justify, there's a lot more that justifies it, but it could, like, that's a music video right there, that first time that song plays. The album is Arrival, the song is Arrival, it starts the moment that they arrive at the island. It's just perfect. And also it then relates to the previous one. We have The Other Side of Paradise. It's very similar in that way, where you're like, oh, here's this paradise, oh, look how beautiful, oh, there's an underbelly, oh, there's another side to it, you know. And that speaks to a theme. So there's like an on-running theme throughout all of these. But you have King Kong, obviously, like, you know, double K, 11, 11, 22 letters in Hebrew alphabet. You can go on with that kind of stuff. But I didn't pick up on until like the third time that I watched it, that even though it's so obvious and right in my face, but it's Dancing Queen is the second song on the album after I Kissed the Teacher, right? And I'm like, the lyric of Dancing Queen, if you start the album, the second that the movie starts, actually falls on the intro line of where it says King Kong. And she is a dancing queen looking for a king, you know. I love that. There's an article about Dancing Queen where you don't need an article to tell you this, but that song is like one of the saddest songs ever written. Because it's like, you know, this person is older than what's being communicated through that song. Somebody who's looking back on their life and they had this moment where they were in that place and they're at that time and it will never come back. But the paradox, the catch-22 of them being in that moment, that if they were not ignorant of the greater reality of where they would end up or whatever, it wouldn't have been fulfilling. They needed that obliviousness to give it its fulfillment, which is only recognized in retrospect. And it's a very deep point, just in general about life, you know, and even maybe the unrecognized value of ignorance. So kind of like, you know, Dancing Queen is in large part about the unrecognized value of being ignorant of something. And it's very paradoxical, but, you know, it's a profound point. And so, you know, when you watch King Kong, you know, obviously the film on its own, I mean, there's some bizarre stuff happening. You have when King Kong is first introduced in New York City, he comes out in underneath a giant petrol container. So they have him in a giant gas tank, you know, the gas station setup. And so they lift that up and then he's in New York. He climbs the two towers. You're like, oil, you know, Iraq, not like all the 9/11 symbolism, Tisha B'Av stuff is just completely off the top, over the top. And so, yeah, it's like, you know, the king and the queen, it's Beauty and the Beast, you know, the Oz card in tarot, the strength in tarot, what Crowley would call lust, actually connects Chesed and Gevurah, which are the two pillars of the lower worlds of the Kabbalistic tree of the seven lower Sephirot. And the pathway that connects them is strength, which in Hebrew is Oz. So you say the two pillars are called Yakin and Boaz. So literally the first pillar established the second pillar in strength. So you have the right is established, the left is in strength. That in and of itself communicates a paradox of where you say if something's established in strength and the strength is in where it's established, which is the right hemisphere. And then the left is the further replication, but it can never actually, you know, it can only point back to its source. And really the two are one. And so even though they appeared separate to us, they're not actually separate. And so I see that communicated with the two towers, King Kong dying at the two towers in that film is very significant. There you go. Arrival, King Kong, 1976.